This is Costa Rica, the land of volcanoes, beaches, rainforests, and traffic. So much traffic.
I was born and raised in Costa Rica, and it baffles me that there's this much traffic in such a tiny country. So I did what anybody else would do. I scoured through government data, looked at so many maps, just to answer the question, why is there so much traffic in Costa Rica? And if you're yelling at the screen, cars cause traffic, well, yeah, cars cause traffic. But that is such a lame answer that skips over a juicy story about how data can show that induced demand creates the right conditions for car-centric places and indeed, traffic.
Costa Rica has just over 5 million people, and it's half the size of Florida. But while the beaches and rainforests are out here, around 60% of the country's entire population lives in this small valley. This is where traffic is worst. It's really bad. On average, people lose 24 minutes on a 1-hour trip. The average car velocity at peak travel time is only 14 kilometers an hour.
This is the speed of a nice bike ride. I left Costa Rica a while back, but even back then in high school, I had to wake up 5 minutes earlier each year to avoid traffic. And if there's one thing I hate more than car-centric places, is waking up early. The first obvious answer is a growing population. The more people there are, the more traffic there is. But if it's obvious and the first thing you think about, then it's most probably wrong. While doing research for this video, I found this cool graph that explains it better.
Basically, there are more cars registered in the country than there are babies being born. In less than 10 years, Costa Rica went from 150 cars per 1,000 people to 230. It now ranks as the third Latin American country with the highest number of cars per capita.
Okay, but like, why are so many people buying so many cars in a relatively short amount of time? This is the start of a car-dependent cycle.
Coinciding with this car boom, the early 2000s saw expansions and upgrades to the Central Valley highways. This one, connecting Heredia and Alajuela, got upgraded from 1 to 2 lanes each way. This one, running between the two most populous job centers, Alajuela and San Jose, also got expanded from 2 to 3 lanes, with some sections having 4 lanes each way. This one, running into San Jose and connecting it to Escazú and other suburbs, got expanded in 2008 from 2 lanes each way to 3. Before this ring road was even finished, its capacity was increased with elevated crossings and even more lanes. Yeah, the ring road is not even a ring yet, and they're still increasing its capacity. In 2023, the road got more expansions that have been opening up in the last few months. This is what some of those elevated crossings look like from the ground. Larger lanes exclusive for cars, and roundabouts where traffic is supposed to mingle at slower speeds that were designed like highways, with concrete barriers meant to stop cars traveling at highway speeds. And pedestrians, they're just never prioritized. On paper, the expansion of this highway technically has a bus lane at certain points, but try really hard to find that bus lane in this picture here. This one was one of the expansions in 2008. Look at the nice 3 lanes that cars have. Now look over at the people waiting in line for the bus, in the rain, without shelter.
While all of this infrastructure was being built, the bus system was simply ignored. Well, it's not really a bus system at all.
It's more of a collection of different companies that run bus routes to approximately the center of San Jose. Each bus fare is paid separately, with no universal payment system. Schedules are non-existent, and buses are infrequent. There are over 20 different bus terminuses. Terminuses? There are over 20 different bus terminuses that don't end in the same place, with no central station for bus transfers. People need to walk up to 1.5 kilometers just to transfer buses. This is what a bus terminal looks like. This is where the bus route ends. It has no shelter, no sign. It's just a line of people on the sidewalk. In 2008, 54% of people used public transportation as their main means of moving around, sharply dropping from 75% in the 90s. This means that at the time of the highway expansions, the mobility of the majority of the people was simply ignored. Now, buses had to compete with cars in highways not designed for public transit. Now, whenever traffic jams happened, buses would be stuck in the same car traffic, dropping the quality of the bus service. Obviously, as the quality of bus service dropped, people switched to driving cars, creating even more traffic and worsening the problem. By 2019, only 34% of people moved solely by bus. This is still the plurality of people, as only 33% of Ticos get around by private car. There is a train that also runs in the valley, but here is a sample of its schedule. Good luck catching the 3 trains in the morning, or if, I don't know, for some reason you need to travel between 10 a.m. and 3 p.m. I wish I could talk about bike lanes, but they're basically non-existent. This is a shame, because Costa Rica has a huge cycling culture. However, it's a culture focused predominantly on sport, rather than transport.
Prioritizing highway expansions, expanding bridges, and repaving roads for high-speed traffic while ignoring public transit, walking, and cycling has consequences. People move and adapt to the infrastructure that surrounds them. This pushes people further away from the city and has them using their cars as their sole means of transportation.
This is where the last piece of the puzzle fits in: the lack of urban planning. In the US, the government sections off pieces of land and mandates that only single-family homes can be built. Costa Rica is not the States. There is a distinct lack of planning on where people live, work, and leisure, as most regions don't even have a zoning plan. People just move to places where it's convenient to live. The newly built highways offer a convenient place to live, as long as you have a car. The government also knows that this is a problem that directly causes traffic. They study what causes traffic and how to solve it, and report on it on their yearly review. Here it is in their 2015 State of the Nation, and then again in 2019. This lack of planning manifests itself in a weird way. Borrowing from the US, Costa Rica started to develop housing that resembles single-family exclusionary zoning. They are these close-gated condominiums that emulate the suburban US life. Some of these are actually quite dense compared to the suburban US, but they shoot themselves in the foot by making walking, cycling, or taking the bus for anything other than recreation so impractical that all the people living in them just use their car for everything. Inside the walls, there are only houses, making any walking trip to the grocery store or a restaurant an endeavor, as short distances on the map are deceivingly long walks. Say you live here, a mere 250 meters away from the nearest supermarket. Well, walking will take you almost 8 times as long, with a 24-minute, 1.2 kilometer walk, a third of which is just to reach the gate. Or, say you live in Condominio Dendera Lindora, and you want to see your next door neighbor in Condominio Villas del Sol. Easy peasy, just walk 1 kilometer all the way around. Good luck. This is what one of them looks like as it's getting built. Technically, there's a supermarket right in front, but I guarantee you, no one that will ever live here will ever walk to the supermarket. There's no sidewalk, the recently paved road has no markings, and cars are traveling at any speed. Closed-gate condominiums force people to drive. Between 1990 and 2017, the total area under construction being designed to be closed-gated communities grew by 600%. This study examined traffic within a 2 km radius around 215 of these communities, and after the completion of a condominium, the study found that traffic increased between 20 and 40% between 2015 and 2019. Take a closer look at these closed-gated communities on the map. At first, they seem randomly placed. Now, I'll just add the recently expanded highways. And would you look at that? What a coinkydinks! The expanded highways just so happened to snake across most of these communities. The ones that are not located near the recently expanded highways just so happen to be located near other highways and other major roads with high speeds.
Developers took advantage of these newly expanded highways that the government built and built car-centric condominiums. This car dependency is then further ingrained into the infrastructure with the dumbest of policies, parking minimums. When I began doing this research, I thought Costa Rica doesn't even have zoning. No way they have parking minimums. Yet, here we are. This is chapter 20 in the construction regulations of the National Institute of Housing and Urban Planning. You can find a list of how much parking you need for houses, sports facilities, concert venues, religious venues, restaurants, and yes, bars. Yeah, That's right, we do not want you to drink and drive, but if you do want to drink, we have to include a spot for you to drive.
After a mere 10 years of expansions, the highways are already at capacity, and expansions are being considered again for the same highways. This vicious loop of lack of planning, expanding highways, and pushing car-centric designs onto people have left the cities with constant traffic, polluted air, and thousands of deaths a year. We have ceded all public spaces where kids used to play and people would walk to more and more cars. This was avoidable. In the plan for a city a decade ago, the government knew about this. Here it is in their opening statement about mobility in the Center Valley. This video went through so many iterations in my head. Honestly, I just wanted to talk about bike lanes. But the more I read, the more I got frustrated, because Costa Rica is littered with compact cities that could serve as nodes in a wider bus system. Instead, the government keeps building roads that are full of loud cars on one side and not so loud cars on the other. People choose to live in these condominiums for safety and tranquility, which are obviously valid reasons, but they don't have to be car dependent. They could be built with wide sidewalks, bike lanes next to supermarket or pulperias, and even connected with better public transit.
So here we are in 2024, and at least we know what the problem is and potential solutions to it. But still, highway expansions are being pushed through while a project to revamp the train has been sitting idle for years, and all I can do from far away is complain to a camera.